you guys then for the, introducing me. Thank you. My name is Yara Khoury. I've been working on a project for 2 years, before 2 years. I mean, it started 4 years ago. The research took me 2 years to finish. I had to go up to Nasri Khattar's house, which I will introduce now, and dig through his archives for the unified Arabic letterforms that he had proposed in the early 1930s. The concept of unified Arabic, Al-Ahraf Al-Arabiya Al-Muwahhada. So, this is Nasri Khattar. He's a Lebanese architect, a product designer, and a type designer. He was not formally trained as a type designer. He was born in 1911 in Lebanon from a small family, a Quaker family that lived in Brumana, for those of you who know Lebanon. And then he was a child prodigy somehow. At the age of 14, he applied to enter the American University of Beirut. And then he was kicked out because he was just a boy in shorts. And at the age of 16, he reapplied and went to the American University of Beirut and finished his business administration degree. So at the age of 22 somehow, he started to work at AUB for 4 years as a staff member, not as a teacher. And one day, one of the teachers of the typing course, the Arabic typing course, was absent. So he took on his role and said, okay, I will teach that, I can type. And in an attempt to welcome the students of the class, he wrote down on the typewriter that was present at the time, and it's probably a Saloum Kerzel typewriter, Ahlan wa Sahlan. But instead of doing this, he wrote this. Now, for any Latin user, that's easy to see that, no, let me go back. This he made a mistake, okay? So he wrote the same hey in the same form in the middle of the sentences instead of changing it. And for Latin users, of course, the letters don't change shape according to their position in the word. We all know that, unless they are capitals or stuff like that. But in Arabic, they do change. Most of the letter forms change. So when he looked at this, he got his eureka moment, let's call it. And he said, oh, this works. And since then, he embarked on the journey of his lifetime. And said, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. I want to save the world. This is. In 1934, 2 years later, he was in the United States with his brother. In Connecticut, he finished his first letter forms, and this is the first record of unified Arabic in 1934. The first set is a high contrast set with little zulufs, like serifs, okay? The second set he was trying to draw was a low contrast set, sort of a sans serif in his mind, I think. So that is in November 1934. This is it. This is the system. This is how it works. Instead of changing letter forms, he was calling for one form per letter concept. So let's, if you can read this together. هذه الكلمات الست تتركب من ثلاث حروف جديدة لا تتغير شكلها أينما وقعت. أما لو أردنا أن نطبعها بالحروف العادية فيلزمنا 12 شكلا من الحروف بدلا من الثلاثة. Now, I'm used to reading this a little bit. My eyes got used to this. And there is the poetry that is written. He tried to do poetry with it, so I could read it easily. I don't know if you can, but... Anyway, the letter meme, for example, with its four basic variations and more than 30 ligatures, would be replaced with one shape only. That is the concept of unified Arabic. Detached or attached, so please there's always this connotation that Nasri Khattar's unified Arabic is detached. No, that's not acceptable. But actually, the concept is unification and has nothing to do with whether it's detached or attached. Unified Arabic also eliminates the variants, as Khattar called them, or ligatures. وباشتقاق الحروف الجديدة مباشرة من الخطوط المألوفة أصبح كل رسم جديد يشتمل على أهم ميزاته الأساسية الموجودة. I don't know if you want to try to read this. Now, the trip takes us from Connecticut in USA to, actually he went in the meantime to Colombia, where he, in the USA he trained as an architect at Yale under Frank Lloyd Wright's apprenticeship. So he's a really good architect, he's a product designer, and he was doing this on the side, you know, as his small little project. But he needed the money, so he worked as an architect. In Colombia, the records say that he got a call from the US, probably from his brother, telling him, Nasri, there's somebody very important who really is interested in your project. Apparently, it's IBM. And Thomas Watson, the founder of IBM, was very interested in that because he saw a commercially viable project in that, that maybe we could produce the typewriters that would change the face of how we type Arabic, because typewriters were very hard to use at the time. You had to make makeshift keys and change a lot of things while you are typing, so you had to really combine lots of keys to change each letter according to its position. This is his first trip to Cairo, which took him to Cairo. This is the IBM typewriter. Thomas Watson sent him to Cairo with six IBM typewriters to make showcases out of them and try them out in front of the public, in front of schools, in front of other people. To do the typewriter, he actually had to also design it somehow. The layout of the letter forms, he also studied. He didn't take the original ones, how they were placed. He did a frequency test of all the letter forms, and he did a whole new layout for the letter forms on the typewriter. So it's quite a bit of design there in product design. So Watson saw a lucrative and genius solution for the technology somehow, and became quite personally involved in his backup for Nasri Khattar. And did this beautiful dinner, luncheon, at the Waldorf Astoria in New York, where he invited lots of people from all walks of life, very important people, critics, writers, thinkers, you call them. You say there was Philip Hetti, Elia Abomadi, Bourkeba, who was not even the president, Habib Bourkeba of Tunisia, and one important person was there, that is Dr. Frank Laubach. We will talk about Laubach in a minute. So he went with six, this is the only surviving typewriter that was found, because he had dismantled most of them, and he had actually dismantled this one. So this is now found in the AUB archives, if you want to go there and study the way study his reform experiment. So, okay, these are some typewriter samples he had used. This is a Mutanabbi poem. كم قتيل كما قتلت شهيد بياض الطلا وورد الخدود. Anyway, so these are samples, a lot of samples I found that he had typed on the typewriter. He also did this one. He printed Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the opening of the Quran. And I can see in most of the reform proposals that we will talk about later that lots of proposals came with Surah Al-Fatiha because it was a measure of validity. If people could accept a holy text like this in the proposal, then it would be somehow acceptable. So so this was the ultimate test. If that would be acceptable, then we're on. Dr. Frank Laubach, he is the father of literacy, and he is a very renowned person, educator, who went on, he's a missionary, by the way, and he's an expert and author of many books on literacy issues. He was sent, Nasri Khattar was sent with this guy, Frank Laubach, to Cairo here in the 1940s, I think. On a mission for literacy, and they had to present to King Farouk at the time, using unified Arabic. So this is the manual, and we will see pages on the inside that use unified Arabic. Now, on the manual, I didn't see any copyrighted material or anything mentioning unified Arabic, but he assumed, Laubach, that he would do duality. He would put the unified Arabic and the traditional forms, and this is how he would teach. These are some of the pages also, so you can see he's always doing this and this, sa, si, su, and he's using, of course, king's pictures, medic, and he's using these. And then he does this sort of work where he illustrates illustrative pages. So again, the duality, stuff like this, like bab, qaf, qitta, ra, rajul, wa, warda, noon, nar. So he was playing around with illustrations and stuff like that. Okay, but I would like to read to you a letter I found from Frank Laubach. Laubach recounts in a letter to Khattar the success he had in teaching beginners using unified Arabic. He says, "I had a very exciting experience this afternoon. They brought in an illiterate girl of 9 years. I taught her one lesson in front of one class and another this afternoon in front of another class. She is ready right now to read any easy book with Khattar letters. She will have to spend days or weeks learning how they look connected. Oh, how I pray you may succeed, for learning Arabic will be child's play when they use your letters." Now, wishful thinking again, but this is another form. I thought maybe something from Frank Laubach, this strong testimony would be good. Now, the Cairo connection again comes back. I asked somebody yesterday about the origin of the sentence, Masr taktub, Lebanon yatba' wal'iraq yaqra. I mean, this is a debatable issue. This is an overused sentence, and I don't know how really feasible this is at this stage. Somehow, but when this sentence came out, it somehow epitomized the general mood or fruits of the Arab cultural and political renaissance of the first half of the 20th century. This movement made its mark in literature, in political views, in new religious interpretations, and in language reform. And of course, somehow, it had to reflect on the letter form and the alphabet it was using. So, we come to the Cairo Academy. Within, an important outcome of this movement at the time was spread out organizations like the Damascus Academy in 1919 and the Cairo Academy of the Arabic Language in 1932. Now, a year later, after the Academy opened, they launched a worldwide search for reform systems and proposals for writing systems in Arabic. The search lasted 35 years, 1933 to 1968, and they received 266 proposals for reform. Nasri Khattar was the only one to do it twice. He proposed in different years, in 1947 and 1957, 10 years later. This is a small account of what follows. Now, the Academy received so many proposals, but they were actually divided into four basic categories. One was Latinization, the other one was original letter designs, completely new, out of this world letter forms, and diacritic mark system innovations in finding solutions for the vocalization, and reduction of characters where Nasri Khattar sits. This is Abdelaziz Fahmi, this is Latinization. Of course, this is exactly the copy, this is the Ataturk success story, basically. They said, okay, why don't we go by the Turkish example and do this for the Arabic? In the academy itself, there were two factions. One was really, really going against anything that had to do with Arabic. Not really. To the first faction said, give me anything. I would accept it. Let's study it. We are open to any proposal of reform. The second proposal, the second faction in the Cairo Academy, where there was lots of fighting and deliberating, said no, any proposal had to follow al-usul wal-asas, like complete respect to the Arabic letter form. Now, Abdulaziz Fahmi completely said no, and he did this. Another one, Dawood al-Halabi. Roland Meynet had a book called Like Scribbles on a Piece of Paper, his idea goes on. So none of them actually designed, except in this category where the reduction of letters had lots of designers putting in some work. Like Yusuf Soub in the fourth category, and it is based on Brahim Yazici's late 19th century simplified letter collection. This is Ahmed Akhdar in the fourth category from Morocco. And this is actually adopted in Morocco. You can see the complexity of the fourth category, how designers deal with this issue, with a very serious issue. So he actually did a clavier keyboard where he put his letter forms. He also did it in, this is Kufi, this is Ruqa, this is Diwani, this is probably Nasr. And now we come back to Nasri Khattar's proposal. This is his page, I think, and it looks quite well designed, at least, and for the time. He makes a good case to the Cairo Academy. He even gives them the type case, Sanduq al-Huruf al-Muwahhada, where he actually placed all the letter forms in the type case. You want me to go back? Okay, and mind you, in Cairo, in the newspaper Al-Ahram, it was quite well covered. This is a live issue. It was a really a big issue for lots of thinkers and writers at the time. In 1959, Al-Ahram uses Khattar's images here, and it had a section that says Al-Mujamma al-Lughawi yabhath bitaysir al-kitab al-Arabiya. So this was a serious issue for them. This is another, I don't know if it shows actually, this is another Ahram press coverage, and this is the title. So they are experimenting with unified Arabic. They actually used unified Arabic in the titles in Al-Ahram. Trying, well, does it work? Will, huh? No, the fourth foundation. Is it too long? No? Now, nothing came out of the Cairo trip, of course, with the six IBMs. He went back to the States. He worked as an architect. Laubach didn't work out. Also, his relationship there didn't work out. Then, suddenly, he was in Iran. He was on a trip to Iran building 9 military complexes. And he bumped into a person from the Ford Foundation involved in literacy issues. And he pitched to him this presentation of his. And this guy went crazy about it and said, oh, no, I should take this to higher management and let me see what happens. And that's how he took it. Just he took a Ford Foundation grant in 1957, which lasted for 5 years. He took quite a lot of money then, which ended up in him traveling with his family back to Lebanon with his kids and his wife, and developing the organization, the UAAF, Unified Arabic Alphabet Foundation, an official one. And then he started printing lots of material, marketing material, doing movies, and all of that stuff. But mind you, before 1957, in 1950, he also drew, he was a paranoid sort of designer, and he also drew patents on his in the US. This is a patent in UA Beiruti, and this is in UA Kufi. So he was very keen on drawing patterns and safeguarding his rights in this, if it ever got into play. This is Nasri. He also produced metal type. That's from his house, and now it's in the AV archives. 36 point type. This is a movie he did. So he says, Mr. Die Hard gets arrested or something like this. So it's a movie with marionettes. He did it in the US. And there's a Sayyid Mut'ib who is very skeptical about this and says, what is this? This is blasphemy, you know. What are you doing with the Arabic letter forms? And then Nasri Khattar come in person and plays a role in telling him the story and how good it is for mankind and all of that, until you reach where Sayyid Mut'ib actually is like, oh, this is really good and we should do that and all of that. So it's a funny movie. After that, with the Ford Foundation, he worked in Aramco, Saudi Aramco, and as an engineer, as a calligrapher, actually. And he got to see his letter forms for the first time on signage. It really worked well for signage at the time, because they were actually pieces that you could produce 30 letter forms, that's it, in all sizes, and just click on the signage system. It was an easy unit-based design. So this is Madrasat Khadija al-Banat fi al-Dammam. This is a school that is opened by Aramco. So that's why he got to see it, actually. These are all the schools he actually did the signage of. The only record is this one. But I have found all of these drawings for the schools. He also did this signage. These are photos from his house. This is a huge Asr Electron. He really believed in, he was a modernist at heart and believed in the digital age. But I can tell you a story later about that. These are clip-ons, like pins, with rivets at the back that he used here. You see these? This is a sign in actually Hamra in the 1960s for a movie. So the cinema used it. And these are some sketches. I will go back to what was going on in his mind before he actually designed those final letter forms. I mean, it is very clear that he wanted a very, let's call an X height, or the counters of the forms were all unified and large enough. Stuff like this, where he connected the form. So he thought maybe the dots are a problem. Let's connect them. Or here, where he does this. These. So your ye is like this instead of this. And your sheen is like this, I guess. The sketches are really amazing. You can trace, and there's a lot of them, you can trace a pattern of thinking and what was he really trying to solve in each proposal. Here he was doing the same diacritic sign solution, actually. Here you can see that he placed the vocalization mark over the complete letter form. Or he connected them. Doesn't matter whether they're connected or not. He also did a game called Abjad, where you have pieces like this, and you play around with them for any language, Latin and Abjad game here. Yeah. He really copyrighted everything he did. He was such a paranoid person. These are some of the sketches. So you can see he is a calligrapher somehow, like self-trained calligrapher. His agony with the meme. Thousands of these are available. He really kept everything quite organized. This is him in the late, have you met him, Leila? I saw you doing this. This is him giving a lecture in the late 90s, before he died, right before he died. He was carrying this meme, and in his lecture he was really bitter. He was a bitter man at the end, that he really believed in this idea that would really save the Arab world from the dark ages that he believed we live in. And this meme is the love of his life, I think. I'm sure his wife is jealous from this meme. He held it and said, "You know how much time it took me to design this meme?" Anyway, he was scribbling around with digital typefaces, thinking that maybe somebody would, if I did it digital. Again, Abjad, I don't know why I did this here. These are huge wooden forms I found. I think he softened up towards the 70s and 80s. He was doing things for An-Nahar. He was suggesting An-Nahar typeface, like the most major newspaper in Lebanon. So you can see that there's a unification, but he was doing stuff like this. You know, he was like, maybe I could get a job doing this stuff. It's Moirit, the name, but he kept this, his signature. Shuf Baba Shuf. Now, maybe I'm near the end if I took too much time. Shuf Baba Shuf is a book that he wrote and he illustrated. And he does the same Laubach experience. He does the traditional form and the unified detached form. He drew these and did this. So here, is this clear? Yeah. So he does a line in unified and another line in the traditional forms. And he says, which two letters on the top of the page you are learning here? I think one of the publishers in Beirut are interested to republish this book. He has a code at the covers of the book saying, yeah, top, top, please, as if that's not clear. Anyway, يركض من أمام لا يذهب إلى المدرسة لأنه صغير. These are enlargements from the pages. And just a small story. Other than the Laubach's letter that he had taught a girl in one day to read, and oh, how he wishes all of that. I actually, my daughter was 6, maybe 5 years old, and she was starting to learn the letter forms. She took no time, really no time to learn this. And she didn't only, not only not learn it, read the pages, she actually wanted more. That doesn't happen, really, that doesn't happen. This is like a miracle for me, seeing her flip the page and want to read more Arabic. So this is a call for, not because I want to obliterate this, of course not, okay? But this is a call, a literacy call issue, an educational call, and not a change, a formal change in the Arabic script. So for all of you who are interested in issues like this, to go to the AAB library and where the archive is and study this and give this 70, 80-year-old experiment another chance, especially in the learning phase of Arabic. I am sure, I'm really sure that anyone who doesn't know how to read, like foreigners, would really actually find it very easy to learn it in one day, the letter forms, and read, because it's quite easy. So, and then they could jump to the connections, and then they could jump to the ligatures, and so on, until they master it. So, these are pages from the book that was the fruit of this research. And, of course, course, in design, this could be an interesting issue too. This paper I saw was like a dream. This is the skeleton of the letter forms, and you could fit it up with any sort of skin. And that is the, what he should have copyrighted, actually. I will end with the validity and not soundness of a given work is not measured by the support or backing of its contemporaries. So maybe another trial later on in 100 years after after this experiment, somebody finds it much more valid than what it was before. Thank you.
Thank you, Yara. It was really amazing presentation.
Thank you.
And I think for the audience here in Egypt, that's really very fresh and very new. Yeah. And especially also about the part that he's in research in Egypt. And if we have any questions for Yara, too many questions.
Thomas, did we agree on yesterday?
Okay, we can start with Thomas and then Madriz, or vice versa, Madriz.
Ladies first.
I heard so you like. Yes, please. Yes, yes.
Please. I don't need to. I think my voice.
Please take the microphone.
Thank you, Yara.
Because the people that need like, please take the mic.
Yara, I want to thank you mainly for your passion. Your passion is contagious. I love it. I wish all designers can get this from you. Because really, even if you're not interested, you become interested. I have two questions for you. One is, how did you come about to start this? I mean, how did you know about Nasri Khattar and how did you start? Okay. And the second question would be, do you think you would want to carry on what he started and push it further? I mean, do you see yourself getting involved and doing more rather than just writing about it and researching? Would you think, you know, how do you see it going?
Yeah. The project actually started in my master's degree where I did a lot of research on reform trials in Arabic script. And one of my best friends told me, oh, there's this guy, Nasri Khattar, he lives in Mansouriyeh, please check out this document. And he got me a document where Nasri Khattar was actually nominated for a Nobel Prize. He was nominated for a Nobel Prize, so he had the document of the nomination for the Nobel Prize. He gave that to me, and he took it actually from his wife, Jackie. So that's the only contact I had in 1999 with him, about Nasri Khattar. And then I did my master's done in type and finished. And then a few years later, Raja Khattar, who is deceased now, told me that his uncle had done this letter form that I want you to know. And I told him, wait, Raja, your uncle is Nasri Khattar? And he said, yes, how do you know about him? I've read about him, he's quite famous in the type world for his experiment. He said, okay, let's do some work on that and get it revived and stuff like that. We worked with his daughter in Texas, it never worked out. Anyway, Raja died, unfortunately, 4 years ago, and nothing came out. The book is dedicated to him, actually, because he was a really close friend. And then Khatt Foundation, who that refers, contacts me and knows about this connection with Nasri Khattar and tells me, why don't you write? And I jump right on. I mean, I would love to do it. And I thought, oh, but he's dead. How can I interview him and know stuff about him? And apparently the archives at his home were quite amazingly all organized, well kept, in rooms where his wife lived in one room, and five other rooms were full of his archives and letters, folders, like a lot of asthma got into that. So that's how I got involved in the project. If I want to continue, is that your...
Where do you keep going?
Where, if I want to get involved in it. I don't know if I want to get involved in it further than this. I have a passion for that. Look, the spark I saw in my daughter's eyes when she read Shuf Baba Shuf is amazing. And I really think it's not my place to study the literacy issues of this reform project. I can't, I'm not an educator for children, you know, or, but I really wish somebody would take this on and give it another trial and see how can it really benefit learning Arabic quite easily and not having this counter affinity to a general, there's a general mood of this in Lebanon at least. Je déteste l'arabe is the clé, the mot de clé of all children in Lebanon. So I wish somebody would take this on. I don't know, I would help as much as possible, but in design, maybe this could pick on, maybe in, I think we are much more open now than before.